You are now listening to the Hunter's Advantage Podcast. I'm Christian Babcock, the host of the Hunter's Advantage Podcast. And what we do on the podcast is we talk to disruptive companies in the outdoor industry, talk about innovative hunting solutions that are changing the landscape, as well as offer you tips and strategy for more successful hunts. All in all, I just want to help you become a better hunter by providing you with high quality knowledge and information that you can trust. Stay tuned. Guys, thank you so much for tuning into this episode of the podcast. This is going to be a rather short one with the owner of Crimson Talon Broadheads, Dave Bittle. Thank you guys so much for tuning into the podcast. I know that a lot of you guys are listening and we're growing every single day. I'd really appreciate it if you would take this episode or any of the episodes that you've been enjoying and share it with one friend and drop me a comment on Instagram at Christian Babcock or at Hunter's Advantage Podcast on Instagram, or you can give us a like or a message on Facebook or YouTube. But anyways, guys, I'm going to let you get to the episode, but I really appreciate the support. So this week on the podcast, I'm joined by Dave Bittle. He's the owner of Crimson Talon Broadheads and also a personal friend. We keep in close contact as he's taken over the company this year. So Dave, why don't you give the listener a little context into who you are and kind of what you're doing at Crimson Talon?
Okay, so let me begin, I guess, Christian. My story is simply that, you know, some people chase opportunity and other people have opportunity presented to them. And I'm really in that latter category. And the reason I say this is that, you know, a number of broadhead companies, broadheads, quite often are created by people who have been hunting for years, and they see a need in the market and then, you know, come up with a new broadhead design that they, you know, feel is you know, better than others. Some people, as I said, have opportunity presented to them. And in my case, I've been selling outdoor gear online for a number of years, camping equipment, knives, broadheads, you know, but manufactured by different people. One of the supply sources that I have, as it turns out, happens to be the OEM fabricator for Crimson Talon Broadheads. And the history of Crimson Talon Broadheads is that, you know, the broadhead came about, you know, I'm going to say, you know, around about 2001, 2002, and was in the market for about 10 years. And then the company died off. And I knew that, you know, and I'd sold their broadheads, you know, along with other ones, but not really paid, you know, a whole lot of attention to it. And I knew they had gone out of business, but again, I didn't really think much about it. But, you know, Reed, who I've gotten to know over the years, we were exchanging, you know, Christmas wishes the week before Christmas. And in one of his emails, for whatever reason, he said, you know, have you or would you consider bringing back Crimson Talon Broadheads? And I thought, you know, that's an intriguing idea. I'd never really thought about that before. So I said, let me think about it. And over the, you know, the Christmas holidays, I did a lot of research. I looked in my garage and sure enough, I had a, you know, a couple of packs of the original Crimson Talons there. So I did a few things. First thing was I made two phone calls. I found the phone, you know, the phone number for Scott Mackey, who was the CEO of the original company. And I said, you know, I love these broadheads. You know, the technology was brilliant. I'm thinking of bringing them back. What do you think? And I just, you know, I suppose in my mind, it was as much to get his blessing as anything else. And, you know, out of respect for, you know, a brilliant broadhead that these guys had created. And his reply to me was, I'm out of the broadhead business, but hey, you know, go after it. I'm certainly not going to stand in your way. And hey, you know, bless you. Second call I made was to the Archery Trade Association and said, you know, this is what I'm thinking. I'll be new in the business. What's your advice? And kindly, they sat down and spent a long time with me on the phone and laid out what the industry was all about, what the hurdles they thought that, you know, I would experience and so forth. And then the third thing I did was my son and I went out and we shot some again just to see, you know, what they would do. And with that in mind, I said, yeah, let's do this thing. So really having made the decision, the question was, what do we do? And like I said, you know, bringing airfoil technology to fixed blade broadheads to me was brilliant when it came up. And really the idea is that, let me backtrack. So right now, most arrows rotate because of fletching. And really it's the fletching that determines the path of the arrow. With airfoil technology built into Crimson Talon broadheads, you're now really driving an arrow from the front. So back in the day, they compared it to, you know, driving a car with front wheel drive or driving a car with rear wheel drive. Really, it was sort of the same kind of thing. By spinning an arrow from the front, what you're doing is reducing wind planing. And also what you're doing is giving a spin so when that broadhead hits its target, it really keeps on turning as it goes through. The result is a quick, humane kill, blood trails that you can't miss. And really just, like I said, all around a really great design, right? So what I attempted to do was not, I didn't want to try to improve on the airfoil technology because there's really not a lot to improve on. But I thought, okay, if I'm going to take this on, what can I do to bring the broadheads into 2019 and 2020? So really what I looked to do starting this whole project was to make, you know, whatever incremental changes I could that would improve, like I said, what is already, I think, a really good product. So the changes, I did a lot of reading. I looked at every broadhead site I could find to see what other people were doing. And really what I settled on was, number one, the ferrule, bring it into aircraft grade aluminum, which is really sort of the standard now for any good broadhead. I wanted to change the nature of the chisel tip to something that would penetrate, you know, the densest bone. And what I really decided on at the end was A2 tool steel. And I'm in love with tool steels because, you know, as I've said in the past, think, you know, things like chippers and jackhammers, that kind of thing, you know, a very solid metal that'll drill through just about anything. So increased the aggressiveness of the tip just a little, upgraded the steel to A2, and then also went with the blades. One of the nice things the fabricator that I was using did was he had imported some German grinding machines. And what that's done is made the blades razor sharp. And some of the comments I've had is that you can shave your arm hair with these blades, and you can. That's the first thing that I tried, and sure enough, I took off a bunch of it. So really incremental changes as we've gone along. The other change I made was for folks who are in Colorado, the regulations in Colorado say that a broadhead or the blade of a broadhead has to maintain the same plane along the length of it, which in my mind makes Crimson Talon really not a good choice. So was brought out a straight blade version of the broadhead. It's identical in all respects, except that it doesn't have airfoil technology built into it. Still one heck of a broadhead. Same tip, three razor sharp blades with three bleeders. It'll make a heck of a hole. And that's really, you know, really what I tried to do. And I think to me, the realization was, you know, when you sell other people's products, you don't really pay a lot of attention to them. But when you put your own name on something, it's going to have to be good. Right. And that to me carries with a, you know, a lot of responsibility. You know, people get one shot every year to go out hunting, hopefully. Right. And I don't want it to be my broadhead that lets them down. You know, I want that to be the one part of their equipment that they can count on and really don't have to think of. And, you know, that's why we offer a complete unconditional guarantee. You know, I don't recommend that people go around shooting rocks and boulders and things like that. But if they do and they break it, I'll replace it. And that goes for the life of the broadhead. So, you know, so realistically, if you start with Crimson Talon broadheads, you probably won't have to buy another set as long as you're hunting. You know, in the interim, what I would tell you is that, you know, I've reached out on social media, you know, Instagram, Facebook, I've gone out to, a number of the, you know, the original pro staff from Crimson Talon Broadheads. I've reached out to, a number of new hunters, and I've had people reach out to me as well. Folks like, you know, True Life Hunting Adventures have already gone out and shot rams and, you know, and wild boar, and have come back with, you know, superlative results, right? I just actually, before coming on here, a local hunter who went out and shot himself a big boar and came back with two thumbs up and said, hey, I'm sold. These things, you know. So I've been getting a lot of positive, feedback. And, you know, I can't say enough about the folks who've started, you know, picking up the banner and believe in these broadheads and believe in what we're doing. We're really trying to bring the best quality broadhead we can to market at a price point that people can afford. You know, and don't get me wrong. I mean, I truth be told, there are a lot of good broadheads on the market these days, a lot of them, right? And you can pay, you know, $100 for a pack. But I'm trying to keep that price, you know, reasonable and still give absolutely the best value we can, right? You know, I had the comment a while ago, so what differentiates you, right? I mean, you know, you can only kill something once, right? So do your broadheads kill better than the other ones? And I said, yeah, I think they do, right? Because it's all about quick, humane harvests. And, you know, if nothing else, I believe in ethical hunting. I believe that you want to bring an animal down as quickly as you can, as humanely as you can. And that's really what's going into the design and the quality of the broadheads. I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. But since we're doing an audio-only format, could you explain to the listener what the broadhead actually looks like? Because I think the Crimson Talon has a really unique look, and so I think it would provide a lot of value to explain what it looks like versus maybe a normal broadhead.
Yeah, so like I said, so what you're looking at is three-blade chisel-tip broadhead with three bleeder blades. And as far as I know at this point, we're the only really, the only six-blade broadhead in the market. We have a rather a unique color scheme. It was originally coined as a ferrule flage, sort of a takeoff on the word camouflage. And it's sort of a camouflage type look between silver and red or black and red, whether you're using the G2 or the G2 hyperspeeds. The chisel tip, we decided to leave just the basic tool steel color. But really what's going to, as soon as you see it, the vent in the blade is the shape of a talon, and it's the curve in the blade. It's the airfoil that you're never going to miss, because there's not another broadhead that looks even remotely like this, right? So they're instantly identifiable. I think that's about the most of what I can say, at least about the hundreds, right? The 125 grain will be available in a couple of months. What we've done with that is spent the extra 25 grains into the chisel tip to make it really aggressive. That's going to be a bone buster.
Oh, of course. So the one thing that I think is unique to Crimson Talon is the idea of the spiral wound channels, which is basically the idea that the broadhead continues to spin as it goes through the animal. So what do you think the difference is in a cut with a Crimson Talon versus, just a normal fixed blade broadhead? And how's that going to help you harvest more animals?
Right. So the theory of this is that most fixed blade broadheads are going to cut along muscle lines, right? And cutting along muscle lines is going to create a wound channel that can easily close. And if a wound channel can easily close, there's not going to be, obviously that blood flow and a quick drop. These broadheads, as you said, continue to spin. So first of all, we're working at really sort of 30 degree angles as opposed to 60 or 90 because of the bleeders. And because the blade keeps spinning, it moves through sort of like a drywall screw. I mean, sort of once it hooks in, it just keeps on going. And there are various comparisons, but to me, it's sort of like coring an apple. It creates a hole. And that's probably the best way I can describe it. And creating a hole that doesn't clot, it doesn't stop. And if your shot isn't optimal, the animal's still going to bleed out very, very quickly. And again, my big concern is that, you really don't want to, wound an animal and then have to chase him for half a day, right? You want to drop him immediately or within 30, 40 yards, maximum. And that spinning broadhead does exactly that. And I've seen the blood trails and we have some videos up on Instagram. In one case, shooting a hog and it just dropped him right where he stood, right? He didn't even get a step. That's the kind of wound channel that these broadheads create. It's an amazing thing to see. I mean, it's just great technology. And I hate to keep using the word technology, but the end result is the same, right? You want to be sure that when you finally, you know, get the right shot, that the animal drops quickly and cleanly, right? That's what you're looking for. And that's what these things do. They're pretty wicked.
One of the selling points of a fixed head already is kind of the shoot with confidence, because you don't have to compromise. You know, you're not contingent upon a blade opening up. You're not contingent upon, you know, a collar band breaking or anything like that. And so to be able to take the functionality of like an already normal fixed head and add like a circular wound channel that's going to help the animal bleed out more effectively, I think to me that's a game changer. You know, that if that's something that you can absolutely promise that this hole is going to come out looking, you know, like a silver dollar or a quarter instead of, you know, a couple of paper cuts one way, where it's, because I mean, we know, we've all probably all had it happen to us that are listening, that, you know, you shoot a deer, whether it's the hide or a piece of lung or something, those holes get clogged. You know, when they're just slits, they get clogged rather easily, and you jump a deer, you get adrenaline, you get the adrenaline going on one, you only hit one lung, you know, they can go a long ways on that. If you don't have blood to follow, then there's really no way to recover that deer or antelope or whatever. But, you know, this just seems like a good solution to that, because even if you do have one of those less than desirable shots, you might be able to find or recover the animal quickly anyways, because you always know where they're going if they're running away with a hole in them.
Well, exactly. And, you know, the way I like to characterize this is that, you know, Crimson Talons aren't going to turn a bad hunter into a good hunter, but they easily could turn a good hunter into a better hunter for exactly the reason you've just, you know, you've explained.
Yeah, no, I totally get that.
And, you know, and I guess, you know, sort of the other thing I'd like to bring up too, Christian, is that, you know, when we talk about accuracy of shots, right? So I personally tested these out to about 50 yards. And honestly, what I'm seeing, I've had a couple of people tell me there is no difference in trajectory between these broadheads and field points. My personal experience has been about a 3-inch or so drop over about 50 yards. We had some testing done last week by Crossbow Magazine. Their results were consistent with the, you know, with the what our results had been as well. They tested the G2s up to, I believe it was 445 feet per second. And they saw exactly the same thing. When they tuned for that 3 inches, they were able to, you know, put these things in the same hole every time. So, you know, the accuracy is there as well, right? You know, I would say for most people, you know, some tuning required, but, you know, any broadhead is some tuning required, right? Really, the thing is, can you put it in the same spot every time once you've tuned it? And my experience has been yes, and what we're hearing back from other folks is exactly the same thing. So, you know, you're going to get the accuracy for an average shot. You're going to get, as you say, a wound channel that cannot close or clot. You know, this thing is going to do its job, and you can count on it.
Yeah, I definitely agree. I think something that we'd previously discussed is, you know, you shooting through some plywood, and also I think you had mentioned a steel barrel. Now, I know that's not super equivalent to maybe a shoulder of a deer or anything like that, but it does give archers some sort of confidence that, you know, whatever they're shooting through is, you know, the Crimson Talon's been through it before. So what's your experience been with shooting through things that are going to be tougher than anything an archer is going to encounter in the wild?
Okay, so here's the truth of all this. So sometimes boys will be boys and we just like to shoot stuff. back a little while back, I don't know, you know, it seems to be a lot of this stuff happens on Sunday afternoon when we're sitting around a little bored. I don't know. So we decided one Sunday to take on some plywood. So we went down to Home Depot and bought some 3/4 inch ply and built a target out of it and went out to a friend's place and started shooting 3/4 inch plywood. And we were just sort of blowing through the plywood with no problem. And if you go to our Instagram account, Crimson Talon Broadheads, it's one of the videos that's up there. So we were blowing through that and not really, doing any damage whatsoever to the broadhead. So, I got a little bit greedy, I will admit, and decided to double up in the plywood and go an inch and a half. I guess I'm not really too sure what I was expecting. I buried all of the heads in the 1.5 inch plywood, but I had to sort of chisel them out. So I'm not really sure. But what was really interesting to me was you could see the curve of the blades going into the plywood and just a little bit sticking out at the end. So they will bury themselves in plywood quite nicely at an inch and a half. 3/4 inch, like I said, they just sort of blow through. And then the with steel drums the other day, I don't know, I just was in the mood to shoot some stuff again. So was talking to a good friend of mine who's got a farm with 20 miles from here. And he said, hey, I've got some steel drums that if you want to try and put some holes in them, you're welcome. So we went over to his place and the first arrow I shot, we had positioned the drum. I hadn't thought about it, but positioned it in front of a tree. And I thought I saw a bounce back. I was a little concerned until we realized that the arrow had passed right through the drum and it had ricocheted off the tree. So we moved the barrel and proceeded to put a number of arrows right through both sides of the steel barrel. Talk about leaving a hole, a nice triangular hole, coming in and going. That I'm probably going to post that in a day or two on Instagram as well, if anybody's looking. The one thing I will say is that it did dull up the edges going through steel. That I certainly will admit. Now, my the concrete block story with our 125 grain, for some reason, I got it in my mind that I wanted to shoot some concrete blocks just to see what would happen. And very honestly, I'm not sure what I expected, but what I got was not what I expected, if that makes sense. The chisel tip completely buried itself in the concrete, didn't go anywhere, which I was quite happy about. But the force of the impact wound up cracking the ferrule. So I've gone back to the drawing board on those. Not that I think anybody is, if the world is overrun by concrete blocks. But to me, just I have to make the broadhead stronger. It's already going to go through any bone that exists. But I want to be able to stick it in a block of concrete and bury the head in that and have the broadhead come through with flying colors. So that's really sort of next up, which really sort of goes to the plan of what I want to do with these broadheads. As I see the possibility for improvement, I'm going to keep on making incremental changes. Nothing that you're going to really notice by eye, but just to make them stronger, sharper, because I believe that's what people deserve. And I certainly won't, I won't sell any broadhead that I don't believe is the best we can possibly make it. It just that doesn't make any sense to me.
So as far as arrows go, what would you recommend to someone that'd be shooting the Crimson Talons? Like, how heavy of an arrow would they go with, or is the heavier the better going to be the best for them?
We've been shooting, and I'm going to say it's 4mm. I don't think that you, I'm not looking for any really specific arrows. What, you know, the only thing that I would caution is that you're fletching really, you don't want to be working sort of counterproductively to, you know, the spin that the broadhead is giving the arrow already. If you're running, you know, regular fletching, you know, that's straight up to about 3 inches, I think, you know, you're probably good. I mean, we've tested these with a number of different arrows, a number of different crossbow bolts. And honestly, I haven't seen a whole lot of difference, Christian. I really haven't. So I don't know that I've got any, you know, specific recommendations in that respect. You know, I would, like I said, the one word of caution I would have is don't, you know, if you're already using an offset fletching that is spinning your arrows in one direction, you don't want to have that working, you know, counter to the broadhead, right? That's not going to make a lot of sense. But for most people with their setup, unless you're using some of the new, you know, sort of, you know, ultra thin arrows, I have not tested with those whatsoever. So I really don't know. But other than that, you know, no particular recommendations.
Maybe you could tell listeners where they're going to see the first presence of a reinvigorated Crimson Talon Broadheads come next January.
We will be in the innovation zone at the ATA. I stand to be corrected. I believe it is booth D2, but please don't hold me to that. I'm just going off the top of my head right now. But yeah, definitely check out the innovation zone. We'll be there. You'll see us. We're right close to the end. Or right close to the entrance, I guess, to it is when I'm just thinking back about the map. So we'll definitely be there leading up to the ATA. If you're interested in checking us out, Instagram, Facebook, really, you know, where we're pushing the trying to get, you know, more exposure. Website at corecut.com, corekut.com. Anybody who looks at inside archery, we are going to be, you know, taking out some ads and that leading up to the ATA show. So just, you know, generally trying to get our web presence known. You'll see a number of videos coming out over the next couple of months as hunting season hits. I do expect us to do some promotional videos for YouTube. So those are definitely on the slate for the next month or two. That's mainly about it. So I you know, so really Instagram, Facebook, for the most part at the moment. Like I said, YouTube coming up. And it's just, you know, because we're brand new, Christian, it's just creating all of this, you know, all of this material, right? And giving folks the time to actually go out and do the hunting. I mean, it's great for, you know, to get out and shoot stuff. One of the guys texted me on Instagram the other day that, you know, they plan to have a, you know, a video of them shooting a Mack truck. Well, you know, I hope it's not coming down the highway because honestly, I'd bet on the Mack truck. But, you know, I'm going to be interested to see how that kind of stuff, you know, fares out. But the reality is, right, at the end of the day, how do the broadheads work in the field, right? And those are the kinds of videos and the kinds of pictures that we'll be getting a lot of. This is our first season, right? Reinvigorated. So, a lot of what I've been showing are, you know, what the old broadheads have done. And now some of what we're putting up or what the new broadheads are doing. And that's really what's germane to all of this, right?
You guys have a historic brand. I mean, one thing that I wanted to point out here was I knew about you guys back in, I think, 2011 or 2012. So 7 or 8 years ago, I would have been 13 or 14 years old. And I remember my uncle hunting up in Kansas, which I thought was the coolest thing ever. I was from Oklahoma. I knew all the big deer lived in Kansas. But he brought home one day like a 22-inch wide, like 150-inch buck that he killed with a Crimson Talon. I just thought that was the coolest thing. And I walked around for the next year with two Crimson Talons in my quiver that I took off his shelf. I think one he had killed a doe with before. So I have kind of a legacy effect with Crimson Talon. I mean, I remember the brand. I'm so excited that it's back. And I mean, I might have to use some of these myself this season. It sounds really, really like a really cool product.
Well, I think you should. And you know, what I would tell you is that personally, I feel, you know, just extremely privileged, right, to have the opportunity to bring this back. And I have nothing but, you know, absolute respect for the folks who, you know, created this technology to begin with. Because I think they built an incredible broadhead. And I don't want to take, you know, I can't take credit for what this is, because they're the ones who, you know, started it, developed it. Like I said, I was just, you know, extremely blessed to have been presented with an opportunity and the chance to, incrementally make it better. So it's been a privilege for me, and while it is a privilege for me, I'm just hoping that, you know, I want to, you know, earn the respect of, you know, all of the hunters out there who try it the same way that, you know, the original group of guys did as well. So
one more time for people that are listening, it's corecut.com and Crimson Talon Broadheads on Instagram and Facebook. If you guys want to check them out, that's the place to do it. And Dave, once again, thank you so much for coming on the podcast, and I look forward to talking to you again sometime.
A lot of you guys are listening to the podcast, but you haven't left us a review on iTunes yet. If you are enjoying the episodes of the podcast or have a guest that you really have been dying to listen to, feel free to message us on Instagram at Christian Babcock or at Hunter's Advantage Podcast. And please leave us a review on iTunes. It really helps support the podcast. And I really appreciate that you guys are tuning in every week and listening. Thank you guys so much.